I'm a university researcher and teacher in the field of ancient history. I'm not a graphics pro. But SketchUp has had a transformative effect on my teaching and increasingly, I think, on my career and the way I work. And I want to talk about two things that I do with it this morning. One is creating my own visual material for teaching students about the ancient city of Rome and other ancient places too. And the second is teaching students to do the same thing, to take SketchUp, to research buildings from the ancient world and express their research findings visually in the form of a SketchUp model. So I use SketchUp a lot, and therefore I feel in this company I'm among friends. I was saying to Aidan last night, it's very nice to be part of conversations about SketchUp and about technical things, because in my department, everybody else is a classicist and they don't go near this sort of thing. So it's nice to be among friends. But I also feel perhaps a little bit like an imposter in some of the very competent technical company that I have around me here. My degrees are in Latin and Greek and ancient history. I have no technical training until yesterday morning. I'd never been to a formal tuition session on SketchUp. So I kind of taught myself this, like picking up a musical instrument for yourself, I think, and although I can now get a tune out of it, I think like anyone who's taught themselves an instrument, perhaps I've picked up some bad habits, which Basecamp is going to help me to remedy as well. My research interests are in ancient buildings and places and cities, and my introduction to SketchUp came back in about 2006, I think, when I was working on my doctorate, which was on public library buildings in the Roman world. And increasingly, I wanted to express what I was finding out about these buildings in a visual format. About that time, I got my first iMac, and on the Apple website, I saw a link to SketchUp's website, and that combination of hardware and software has served me very well ever since. Later on, as I'll say, I added Cinema 4D to that mix. And when I finished my doctorate and got into my first university lecturer's post at Reading, where I still am, I began to see different ways of including this, what at the time was a slightly eccentric hobby that my academic colleagues tolerated, to bring that more into the mainstream and make it part of what I did in my teaching and research practice. So I continued looking at the ancient city and the way spaces and architecture functioned in Rome and elsewhere, and I continued creating visual resources for students, and gradually this picked up into becoming quite a main plank of what I do there. I hope, in a way, that my lack of formal technical background is sort of an advantage. I mean, it shows, I hope, that interested educators in whatever field can pick this stuff up and run with it and create useful content. And I think it's to the credit of SketchUp that it's pick-upable and learnable both by me and also by my students, because they're not specialists either. They're all taking my course in the context of an ancient history degree, a classics degree, an archaeology degree. Some of them, I mean, they all use Word, most of them use PowerPoint, a few might have dabbled with Photoshop, and that's about it. They certainly haven't done anything in the way of 3D visualization before. But you'll see that they can pick up the software, and within a couple of terms of academic tuition, that's about 20 hours of class tuition time with me, they can produce some really creditable work, and I'll show you some towards the end. And I think that means that what I'm doing ought to be transferable to different educational contexts. My specialism is the ancient world, but I've got colleagues from modern history, archaeology, English, typography and design, systems engineering, real estate and planning in my university, interested in using this sort of combination of tools and techniques to enhance their own courses. So first, I'll talk about my own use of SketchUp and other bits and pieces to create visual material to show ancient Rome, and then I'll move on to how I teach students to do it. First off, this is mine. I've made a large reconstruction of Rome as it appeared in the early 4th century AD, and here it is, all SketchUp work, pretty much all SketchUp work. It's big. When I last counted, it had 608,000 discrete objects in it, about 35,000 of those are pine trees, for example. It takes my 12-core Mac Pro 3 days to render that fly-in that you just saw. So it's taken a while to assemble. The way I build it is to make all the individual buildings that you see in here, whether the major monuments like these temples and basilicas down here, or the city blocks of houses and shops you see in the background, I make all of that in SketchUp. And this is essentially a SketchUp project. The tool set in SketchUp and also the wonderful kind of global community of users and tutorial videos and plugins that surround SketchUp is what made this project conceivable and possible, and what made me think 5 years ago that I could take the slightly mad idea of taking a blank terrain map and filling it with 608,000 objects to create this. The SketchUp models are all based on research into the available evidence for the buildings. So this is a project that I'm doing as an ancient historian, and like any published book or article that I might put out with my name on, I have to be confident that this is the fruit of academic research. So it's not cinematic, it's not trying to be Gladiator, it's trying to make a proposal about an academic reconstruction of the city of Rome, although I hope it looks kind of nice as well, and that's part of the point. What evidence do we use for this? Here's just one example. You all know the Colosseum. Lots of different sources that we can go to for this. Obviously, for this building, the standing remains are the most useful resource, and unusually for the Colosseum, it survives in part to full height. It's actually pretty easy to make a model of. But we can turn elsewhere as well. This is the tomb of one of the building contractors who built the Colosseum, who put it on his tomb there. Here's an ancient author, Suetonius, talking about it. The emperors were so proud of it, they put it on their coins, so we have pictures of it, and you see here the arches had statues in, crowds of people inside it. And there are fragments of a marble map of ancient Rome that the Severan emperors made of the entire city. And those fragments, we'll come back to those later, we can sometimes identify the buildings on them as we can for the Colosseum, and we can use those to get a sense of how an ancient mind reduced the Colosseum to, in this case, a two-dimensional planform representation. So literary, epigraphic, iconographic, numismatic, archaeological source material all combines for each building to produce something that I hope is an accurate and fair representation of how it appeared when new. So I've more or less finished Rome, but it will never really be finished, and I keep playing with it. At the moment, I've set myself a challenge of making a Roman bathhouse with full interior. So here is the Baths of Caracalla. Anyone been to Rome here and seen the Baths of Caracalla? Right. So you know, if I just flip back to Keynote for a moment, you see that they survive very impressively in their bulk and height, but all of the marble decoration, the plaster, the columns is all gone. So it's a good challenge for SketchUp to put the roofs back on and fill in all that detail. So I set myself this as a kind of technical challenge because I'm teaching students to use SketchUp and I wanted to make myself a student of it again. So I worked out how to do 3D coffering and roof planes that curve in two dimensions, which took many late nights and lots of coffee. The nice thing about Roman buildings is that lots of them are symmetrical, so I only have to make half of them. So there is the Baths of Caracalla. And you can see as I zoom out that the way I'm doing this is to proceed from a published ground plan, very accurate plan by an archaeologist called Janet Delane, who published not just that, but in the back of her book, in loads of fiddly fold-outs of dépliant loose-leaf pull-outs, she's got loads and loads of section cuts through the building, so I've scanned and scaled and imported those and put them in the right place. So longitudinal and latitudinal, their sections through the building. And SketchUp just seems to be a natural extension of that kind of archaeological project. I mean, why not make a 3D model of it rather than publish it in 2D section plans in the back of a hardback book that costs about £120 to buy? Make this and you can send it, email it to people or use it for all sorts of purposes. So that's what I'm currently making, and that's quite a fun challenge. As I've gone along through this process, as I say, kind of teaching myself in the way that many of us do, I've developed a lot of tricks and shortcuts and set up all my own hotkey shortcuts on my keyboard, and I've made myself this kind of ready reference sampler of textures and readily reusable components like Roman style windows and doors and columns and porches, staircases, topiary. Bunch of plugins I find very useful, especially Instant Roof with, 10,000-15,000 separate buildings in the model that all require roofs. That saved me a lot of time. The Freddo tools for scaling and stretching stuff. Just discovered offset on curved surface, which is lovely for all those curved vaulted ceilings in the bathhouse. So I make all this stuff in SketchUp and send it over to Cinema 4D, normally as 3DS files, and assemble the city model in there because C4D can handle something that big all at once. So I have a CAD map of Rome. This is modern Rome, so you need to know the modern city pretty well to understand how the ruins fit on top of it. Zoom into another section here. There's the Colosseum. So taking this as the basic reference point inside Cinema 4D, I then bring in the SketchUp models and scale and position them so that they all fit in real geographical space. So here is that section of Rome, and you can see, I'll just flip back again, how everything overlies exactly where it should, which means that it's a geographically honest representation of the city, at least in sort of X and Y dimensions. Z, the height, I have contour maps, but the hills have changed over time, so I have to work out heights for myself. So that's the workflow that I have for this project. And having developed that workflow, it's really just a question of spending many late nights building it, and here it is evolving towards completion. Major monuments first, then the infill blocks, all the city districts, working out how to do the texturing, how to colour in the ground plate, how to add vegetation, until there it is. So that's about 5 years' work in 30 seconds. It wasn't built in a day, as they say. So why have I done this? How am I using it? I've done it partly because it was fun, I have to say. It was just a nice project to be involved with, and it complemented a lot of my more standard research work. I'm writing a book on Roman libraries. I teach an MA course on the city of Rome. I'm very involved in urban topography and landscapes, so partly making this actually was an exercise in teaching myself the layout of the city. I think Ruskin said that you don't understand anything until you've drawn it, and having done every city block, every street, every house, every monument in Rome, I now feel I know the city pretty well, digitally as well as in real life. But I've also done it, of course, to create resources, teaching tools, publication tools, lecturing illustrations, maps, that kind of thing. And that's part of a disciplinary tradition, because for as long as there have been ancient historians or archaeologists, people have been looking at the remains of the ancient world and trying to deduce what they look like as a research task, and then the presentation task is to convey that set of deductions to the reader or the viewer or the listener. And lots of different media have been used for that, but it's always been a basic goal of the archaeologist or the historian. So the standard way of doing it, and the way that you'll find in many undergraduate courses and handbooks and in a lot of the tourist guides to Rome, is the 2D black and white archaeological grand plan like this, which is a fine thing and contains a lot of useful information. But I don't need to tell this audience how 2D and 3D are different things. It doesn't help you with height, it doesn't help you with decoration, it doesn't help you with shadow, illumination, bulk. It's kind of confusing to read if you're not used to reading it. And I do find that undergraduate students and tourists that I take to Rome sometimes on trips and this kind of thing, if they're not used to reading this kind of plan, maybe they struggle with it, or they want something more vivid or more immediate or more real looking. So the painting or drawing is another thing that's been made for centuries now. There's Etienne du Perrac from the 16th century. This is all the same bathhouse, the Baths of Diocletian, early 4th century bathhouse. So there's a reconstruction drawing from the 16th century. There's one of the 19th century French watercolorists take on a reconstruction of the interior of that bathhouse. So we're getting towards height and color and liveliness. But of course, a painting, a drawing, they're from a fixed viewpoint. You can't turn them around, you can't zoom in or out. You can't see how the building relates to other buildings around it unless the artist has chosen to show you that, and if he has, then you're not looking at detail points close in. So another solution is the creation of physical 3D models, and there was a vogue for this in the middle 20th century. This is the best one, Italo Gismondi's Plastico, at the Museo del Civiltà, down at the end of one of the tube lines in Rome. And it's a plaster model of the entire city. It took several decades to make, even longer than my model, 1935 to 1971. As soon as it was made, it was obsolete because new archaeological discoveries changed the map, and you can't go and attack this with a scalpel and cut bits out and put new bits in. It's a historical artifact in its own right now. And it's enormous, and it's fragile, and you have to go a long way out on the tube line to see it, so not many people do, and I don't know how they dust it, for example. So it's a lovely thing, but its usefulness as an educational tool is perhaps a bit limited. What we end up doing is taking photographs of it. Here is Gismondi's take on that same bathhouse, top right. So into this mix of different tools, of course, we can insert the digital model, and here is my version of the same bathhouse. It's vivid for students and visitors to the city, it's colorful, and of course, because it's a digital model, I can look at it from wherever I want and do stuff like this, overlay it against Google Earth graphics. So this maybe conveys the scale of this bathhouse. This, if you know Rome, Termini Station's just down there. This is the bus station. That's a city bus, that's a bus park there. So comparing the size of that bus to the size of the bathhouse and looking at the scale of the city blocks around it, you get a sense of size, and also how the ghost of the bathhouse, the imprint of it, is actually there fossilized in the streets of 19th and 20th century Rome. And when you've done that, you can do this, which you can't do with the other media as well. So we can position them around, navigate around them, light them in different ways, all the stuff you know you can do with SketchUp models. And this is immediately, I think, a better way of teaching students in the classroom about the architecture and topography of ancient Rome. We can use a model like this to look from above, as you saw then, and then to get down nearer to street level in a way that the larger physical models like Gismondi's Plastico can't permit. We can contrast what we might call a God's eye view with a Roman's eye view, and both are useful. We can look at the city at the level of districts, city blocks, planning, maps, or we can get right down and experience it as a viewer, a visitor, a Roman would have done at street level. And actually, the impression of the city you get from those two different levels is very different. Here's an example. This suite of buildings up here, this set of monumental piazzas, is called the Imperial Fora. It's a sequence of them. Successive emperors built them to be close to one another, starting with Julius Caesar, his son Augustus, Vespasian, Nero and Domitian, and Trajan at the top. So about a century and a half of building. And you can see from above that they share the same axes, roughly the same kind of layout, a porticoed square with the temple at one end. They kind of form a unit and a dialogue with each other. And from up above, that's interesting, and we can talk about what that means in terms of the goals of the architects of these complexes. But if you go and stand them inside any one of them, the impression's very different. You can only see the complex of the particular emperor whose forum you're standing in. There's these great high walls either side that shut all the others out. So all the effort and expense of making all the things line up is actually a bit lost at ground level. And it might suggest that Roman architects and planners thought in terms of maps and kind of grand axes, but on the ground, the viewer's impression was somewhat different. But we could also use a shot like this for doing a tutorial on Augustus, who built this, the first emperor of Rome, and the statue programs that he carefully traced down the sides, and the shields of Jupiter Ammon and Caryatids, and what that means up there, and what the inscription and the pedimental sculpture means. The temple is now destroyed, but there's a Roman altar relief from a later emperor that references this temple, has a picture of it carved in the background. So I cut the pedimental sculpture out of that and pasted it back onto the temple. So it's another interesting digital use of different kinds of source material. So God's eye view, Roman's eye view, and, static. Different ways of experiencing the city. And I think this use of digital reconstruction helps to address some of the limitations of other media. And I don't say it's kind of the magic solution that we must all use forevermore, but it's a very useful tool to put into the mix. And returning to the level of the city as a whole, you can see how I might use it in a class. This is just a big picture of the model, and we can just zoom around it. So we might go over to an area like this and think about how, if you lived in one of these tenement blocks here and these windy, mazy streets, I'll come back to this area later, how impressive it would be when you got into a big imperial precinct like that, where suddenly everything is symmetry and marble and space and right angles. So you can start to see what imperial builders are trying to do when they carve out these giant marble spaces in the middle of town. Or we can look at big bathhouses like this, Bath of Trajan, past the Colosseum. Take a look at the Forum, see how it sits in its bowl of hills between the Palatine and Capitoline hills. Over here to the southern campus Martius, and we're in a world now of leisure. See all those theatre buildings, stadium up here. Those of you that have been to Rome will recognise there the Pantheon, which now stands in a web of medieval and Renaissance streets, but you can see here how once it stood in a more grid-like structure of Roman streets.
Where's the McDonald's?
It is there, and that McDonald's... yeah. That McDonald's has my favourite Latin inscription in Rome on it, which is not a classical ancient one, it's a papal one from the 17th century, I think, that says, Pope such and such cleared out all the disreputable taverns that once disfigured this square, and it's now on a McDonald's, which I really like. What we can, of course, as you saw earlier, kind of overlay modern and ancient streetscapes against each other if we chose to do that. So there is a familiar bit of ancient Rome, but in its proper ancient context. So we could just continue kind of surfing around Rome for the rest of the session if you wanted, but I might say some more structured things. Any bits of Rome anyone particularly wants to see? We can come back to this. I don't think I know that one.
Oh, it's just right across, I can't remember what direction, never mind. Right across, from the Colosseum.
Oh, well, it'd be somewhere down this direction then. Oh, how nice. Well, there's a whole bunch of restaurants with awnings that overlook the Colosseum now in this sweep of streets here, just by the remains of this, which is a gladiatorial training barracks for Ludus Magnus. So I think your restaurant's probably somewhere about there.
It's in front of that. I remember that.
Oh, okay. Good. Yeah. The columns, I mean, anything with high levels of polygon count in light columns, I tend to put in now in Cinema 4D and I use them as render instances. So I bought a commercial pack of Corinthian Ionic and Doric columns. I cheated. and I deploy them. I mean, one Corinthian column is about 50,000 polygons, and if a building with 200 of those, for example, it's shooting up the polygon count enormously. So I tend to handle that kind of iterated, heavy-duty component over in Cinema 4D now. But I have got quite a lot of high-detail items like that in the model, yeah. That's difficult, and I try. So trees, I have a vegetation package that I bought off Xfrog, I think. Statues, I really struggle with because I want them in the model. They need to be there, but they're expensive in every way in terms of modeling time. I'm not very good as an organic modeler, and also they slow the render down enormously. So I tend to use fairly standard, suggestive kind of. I started off just using SketchUp 3D people, just all coloured white, you know, standing there like that. But they were wearing jeans and so on. It didn't quite look right. So over time, I've bought or made a great trouble and expense of time to myself, kind of a suite of stock statue types that I now deploy just to suggest there was a statue here without trying to claim too much detail for it. I haven't yet, but I'd like to. That's definitely a future direction. Again, point cloud data. There's a session later, isn't there, I'm going to try and go to about this. Might tax my computing resources, but it's something I'd really like to learn how to do, certainly for getting better statues in. The Baths of Caracalla, we know what statues were there. Many of them survive. I really should have those statues in the model. The only way of doing that, I think, is either to just commission some genius modeler to make them or to use cloud data. And I know they have been scanned, so there are laser scan data for those statues. I will remember to repeat the question for the camera, sorry.
How did you do all the terrain?
How did I do the terrain? I started off using sandbox tools to make terrain from contours. That was years ago. And then as I intersect individual buildings with the terrain, I use SketchUp's own suite of tools for cutting and stamping and stuff. I've also used some of Truck Valley's tools, Instant Road and Site Grader and stuff, to do bits of the terrain. The terrain's a constant work in progress, and it's the thing that I find hardest, I think. What I tend to do is put the building in and then use the smooth tool and the stamp tool and so on, depending on whether it's a terrace or whether it's a cutting into the side of a hill, to form the terrain around it, then re-export the whole lot back over to C4D. And then all the painting on the terrain, so the farmland, the stuff like these roads, the grass, I paint that on in Body Paint 3D with a graphics tablet. So that's like almost like painting. That's quite enjoyable. How do I reconcile the timeline? That's a very good question, and the honest answer is this is a dodge. I chose the early 4th century because that's the time when all the best buildings are all there at once, but I also built every building to look more or less brand new, because if you want to study the Colosseum, you don't want to go and see a kind of decrepit, ruined Colosseum. You want to see, or at least my students, I would be teaching them the building as new. So it's really a kind of chronological fiction, and what I want to do as a future project is make a series of steps over time, which I think brings me back more or less to where I was going to go to with my slides. So I'll cut back into the slides, but I'm very happy to continue taking questions as we go along. Just show you this one, which is a less glamorous part of Rome, the dockyards and the warehouses. This enormous structure here, the Porticus Aemilia, is probably a grain warehouse or maybe a series of ship sheds for Rome's fleet. So areas with very different contrasting characters. This idea of change over time, here is the site of Rome before Rome was built, or when Rome was a series of hilltop villages. And you can see how the marshy, low-lying, unpromising ground between them, if we fade the city back in 500, 600, 700 years later, had become the Roman Forum. The meeting point between all those hilltop villages became, in the end, the meeting place of Rome. So we can do a bit of change over time. But I made a synchronic model, a model more or less at one moment in time of the early 4th century, but with the intention, probably in the future, of splitting it up into phases and differentially aging it.
You could also say that a building that was built over the 1st century was still, from our perspective, relatively new in the early 4th century.
Yes, I mean, you could, and that's the case that that I would make when justifying this choice to people, but there are points in the model where we know that one building partially demolished and overlay another, and there I really have to do that. If time permits at the end, I'll show you some of those. Where I don't have to do that, I tend to show everything looking kind of pristine. And a lot of scholars of ancient Rome who look at this say, well, it's very pretty and that's a problem. Where's the dirt? Where's the kind of ox dung in the streets and the half-burned out buildings and the scaffolding and the smoke? And I might put all that stuff in later at a different date. You can add different layers, of course. But I decided to start with, at least, to make an architectural maquette, a massing model, really, rather than something trying to be cinematic and kind of gloomy and gladiator-like. Yeah, well, there's some great graffiti in Rome and in Pompeii, and I would love to put some of that stuff in. I tend to use the city as a whole, but of course, because all these buildings are separate digital artifacts, I can take them out of the model and put them unrealistically next to each other. These things are, you can see, several hundred years apart and certainly several miles apart in the city, but we can take them out and put them side by side if we want to, if I was doing, say, a class on imperial bathhouses. So it's useful. You can see, I hope, some of the uses I can put it to for teaching. But it imposes upon me a series of choices, branching choices, not all of which can be reconciled into any one model. And I'll go through some of those now. And as I do so, bear in mind that working out the nature of these questions and the answers that I want to adopt to them as a scholar of ancient Rome is the kind of exercise I set to my students when I get them to do this. And that's what makes this, I think, academically something you can teach in the context of a history degree. It's about thinking about evidence and how we use evidence to make informed presentations of the past. Some of these questions we've talked about, the date of the model, the level of detail and how much detail to incorporate and how much to chop out. Another challenge, all that urban backdrop, all that clutter, if we take it out and just have the major monuments that survive really well in a heavily documented, well-excavated, well-published way, the kinds of buildings that ancient authors like to talk about, so we've got lots of literature on them, this is what we see. But that's not a city, that's sort of desert with monuments poking up out of it. It doesn't teach us much about the urban experience of living in ancient Rome. So I have to fill it all in. And all that backdrop, all that clutter, leads to a series of questions, because ever since Rome expanded as the capital of the reunified Italy in the 1860s, it moved out and obliterated all of this stuff, all these suburbs, residential streets, stuff that archaeologists weren't that interested in at the time or didn't survive very well, is mostly gone. So how can we work out where the ancient streets ran, what the ancient buildings looked like? Are we confident we can reconstruct what scholars in my field sometimes call the urban armature, the kind of whole landscape of buildings, as I hope you've seen, is quite important, I think, to the way I try and teach and present the city. Well, it turns out that SketchUp has been a very good tool for assembling what evidence we do have into one place, which is actually not very often done, and then using that evidence to build, in the end, this representation of how I feel the city looked. The kind of evidence that we do have are things like this. This is one of the 1,000-plus fragments of that marble map of the ancient city that was made in the early 3rd century AD, was put up on a wall probably about the size of that wall there. So it was a kind of marble map of the whole city that fell off in an earthquake, probably in the 6th century, smashed into jigsaw puzzle fragments. About 90% of those fragments were stolen and burned for lime in lime kilns in Rome. So what we have is these tantalizing fragments that at least start to show us, for example, how mazy, winding city streets here with rows of shop fronts opening onto them and secret kind of courtyard gardens behind, butted up against and interacted with these big square public monuments. So we can take all of these fragments and scan them, put them all related to one another in printed space, and scholars have been doing this for a long time, so I'm drawing on a good pedigree of scholarship there. But then we can take that stuff and turn it here into two-dimensional SketchUp data by tracing the outlines and filling in the blanks, turn that into 3D buildings, texture it, drop it onto the terrain heights, render it, and there it is. So there's that city district made from those fragments of marble plan. And I've done every placed known fragment of the marble plan I've turned into 3D cityscape, which I think is the first time in the world that's been done, and is a useful tool for judging how this fragmentary marble map corresponds with what we know and what we don't know about the ancient city. Other things we can use, a guy called Rodolfo Lanciani made this beautiful, beautiful map of Rome in the early 20th century, just as the bulldozers were demolishing lots of it to build the modern city. So he records lots of archaeology that's now lost. There's that bathhouse again that we started with. There it is again. So using Lanciani's fragments there to work out which way the major streets ran, that's that area of Rome modeled, supplemented occasionally by bits of excavation data. So this city block here was done in a piece of rescue keyhole excavation when they were building Rome's big railway station. So that I was able to insert as a kind of excavated known supplement, and my book on virtual Rome that I'm writing this summer, we'll have a chapter on housing, and I'll probably use that block as the basis for the chapter on housing, because that's the best known block, I think, that we have. So lots of different sources combining together for the outline, the plan of Rome. And then for turning that 2D stuff into 3D, we can go to places like Ostia, Rome's harbour town, which not many people go to, but is really, really worth going to if you're in Rome. And you see these Pompeii-like streets surviving in their entirety with this kind of multi-story brick apartment block architecture that a lot of Imperial Rome looked like. And also to get a sense of the rhythm and flow of a city built on sort of four or five stories out of brick and timber and plaster and tile, wiggly streets with major monuments popping up at the end of them, as in Rome. Some of the cities of southern Italy I find very useful is to wander around with a camera and get a sense. This is Palermo. That's the opera house where they shot the last scenes of Godfather 3, for those of you that know the trilogy. So that gave me a sort of feel for the rhythm and texture of a city that I think is not very distinct from bits of ancient Rome. So that's my model of Rome and how I've been using it in different teaching contexts. And if there are school university educators here, I hope you might see how something like this could fit into many different subjects. Having produced my own content this way, students really liked it, and they kept coming and saying, well, how did you make this? This is great. Can we get involved? Can we have a go at making it? So being urged on by the students, I thought, well, why not? You know, I taught myself this software. I find it pretty easy to learn. I'm not a specialist. Maybe they could have a go as well. So I started by hiring some student research assistants. I had a project that came with some funding, which is always nice, which was to make some Roman forts for a BBC documentary. This is a field in Scotland full of rather aggressive cows that was once a Roman legionary fortress. And all that survives on the surface are these kind of humps and bumps. It's not very promising for TV. So to tell the story of what was once here, they got me to make this fly-in of the Roman fortress based on the archaeology from the site. And I had some student research assistants to help with this. And I matched this up to tracking shots from a helicopter that really annoyed the cows, a helicopter going over the field. And this was, you know, really fun to do. So my student research assistants were from my own department. They hadn't touched 3D modeling before, and I was able to train them up pretty quickly and get them to produce good work for this documentary. And this went well. It appeared that it was possible to teach non-specialist students SketchUp and get useful work out of them in a relatively compressed time span. So I took it a bit further and created an undergraduate course, or module as we call it, which is entirely based around recreating digitally our local Roman town of Silchester. This is 15 miles down the road from my university. It's dug by my university's archaeology department, so we have loads and loads of data about this site. But as you can see from the aerial, all that survives on the surface now is the wall circuit, there's an amphitheatre up in the trees, and just ploughland, just fields, nothing to see on the surface, which makes it a really good target for digital reconstruction, right? Because you know what's there, you can't see it when you go to visit, so why not digitally recreate it to show people what it once looked like? So my students spend 20 hours of class time spread out over two 10-week academic terms, learning SketchUp, having a series of lectures from me touching on the kind of issues I've been running through earlier in this session, and then making their own stuff, and I'll show you some of it. This fits in with some of the teaching and learning goals that my university has. It's good to get students involved in creating their own content, not just passively absorbing stuff, but actively creating stuff. I think you learn a lot more when you do that. That's certainly my experience of making Rome. It encourages a new approach, but grounded in the traditional questions of handling evidence that is all of our jobs as ancient historians. If they just hand in something that looks kind of gladiator pretty but has no evidence behind it, they get a low mark. If they hand in something that looks okay but is very well evidenced, they can prove why they made it that way, they might get a higher mark. So it has to be intellectually kind of respectable. And learning SketchUp, although it takes a bit of time, is fun. I think all my students would agree by the end of the course that it had been fun, even if at times in the middle of the course they were, you know, sitting up at 3 a.m. swearing at their laptops. And within a humanities degree, right, within a classics, Latin and Greek and ancient history degree, the kind of digital skills they amass by doing that are quite distinctive and quite impressive to employers. Not just SketchUp, which does have real-world applications, and I designed my new kitchen in it last year, but image manipulation, scanning, formatting source material, file management, saving backups, linking images to text in written presentations, all of this stuff is actually quite high-end digital literacy skills, which they pick up almost accidentally by doing this module. And my students tell me, now they've kind of graduated and gone off into the world of work, they talk about this at job interviews. You know, can you show me a time when you've done something innovative in your study? A standard interview question, and they talk about this. So it's good in all ways. It fits nicely, if distinctively, into a classics degree, I think. How does it work in terms of the course structure and how I teach it? I spread it over 2 10-week terms. So normally students will take 3 20-credit modules per term, 6 in a year. But I spread this one out over 2 terms just to give them more lead time in learning the software. And I tell them over and over again the summer before they start the course, you've got to learn the software. You've got to learn the software. And most of them at least have a play with it. So they come in not totally cold at the start of the first term. I start off with lectures about the history of the Romans in Britain, the history of Silchester, the history of the archaeology of Silchester. We move into talks, kind of like what I've been talking to you about, the choices a reconstructor has to make and how you make something academically, kind of intellectually credible when you're doing your reconstructive work, how you handle your evidence. And then we move on to masterclass sessions in a computer lab where I teach them SketchUp up to, I would say, a sort of intermediate level. I get them thoroughly familiar with the native toolset, but we don't really go much beyond that. There's not time and they don't have the need for it, but I tell them where to find further resources if they want to become Ruby wizards and the rest of it. And I supplement the classroom time with this kind of thing, tutorial screen grab videos, when a student says to me, can you just remind me how you made that roof in the class? I started answering those questions by email, and it took so half an hour to write each email, click this, then press this, then do that menu, then rotate, then. And I thought, oh, this is just stupid. So I started making screen grab videos and posting those up in our online learning environment, our Blackboard site. And that's a good way of supplementing class time with digital material. We get up about as far as making terrain from contours using the sandbox tools. That's about the most advanced thing I get them to do. But that's enough to produce some good models, as you'll see. And I take them to Silchester on a field trip as well in a coach. We go and look at the actual site, and they take reference photographs of the surviving bits of masonry and so on, so they can use those as textures in their finished models. And I assess this by 2 assessments. The first one's just a little thing. At the end of the first term, I set them something that I tell them counts for 20% of the overall mark, just to force them to have learned the software by that stage. It's just a kind of milestone to make concentrate their efforts. I get them to make 1 little building from Silchester, you'll see it on the next slide, and to give me a written commentary, which I say, imagine that your model is an essay, the commentary is a footnote to the essay, so where did I put tile on the roof, why did I do that, what kind of tile, what colour, what's the source for it, what's the picture of the roof, I put a doorway in, what's the evidence for that, what was the handle on the door like, you know, where have you looked for Roman door handles. So that kind of commentary exercise reminds them that it's like a mini essay attached to the main event, which is the model. Second term, I tell them to pick any structure from Silchester that they want, and to do a correspondingly bigger, fancier model with a correspondingly longer commentary. And they produce some very nice work. So this is the little building, the so-called church at Silchester, that I get them to make at the end of their first term. So they've had 10 hours of SketchUp tuition by this time. Well, not even that, because the first half of it is lectures about Silchester. So they had about 5 hours of formal class time with me, reinforced by online videos, and I send them to some YouTube channels and to Sketch Education and stuff. So they know where they can get resources, and they come to me with questions. And you can see, even by the end of that first term, not only are they producing really nice work, but they're taking the tool that is SketchUp and using it in imaginative ways that I've not told them. I just say make a model of the church. I don't really get too specific about how they should do it, but you can see kind of schematic things with differential colouring for different sorts of material, exploded diagrams kind of showing the structure of the church, things where they put the roof in a separate group and take it away to show us the interior, kind of photo-rendered stuff of the worshippers' experience of the church with the kind of light and shadow. Plan views up there, the scale is in pes monetalis, in Roman feet. So they've got all sorts of different approaches already. When they've started playing with the software, they can see just how versatile SketchUp can be and how playing with it suggests to you new ways of imagining and presenting the past. And that's essentially what I discovered while making my Rome model. And it's really nice to see students making that same kind of leap of discovery when they get to play with the software and think, how can I use this to imagine and then to tell someone about the ancient past? And then second term, they pick bigger sites, and this is all student work. And for people who've had 20 hours of class time and just been told essentially to go away and play with it until they're good at it, I think this is really nice work that some of them are producing. Lots of different ways of presenting it. This is a video that a student handed in to me just this term, just gone, for her final assessment. That's the excavation trench at Silchester that my university department's been digging for the last 20 years, going back through the phases, back down to earlier and earlier phases of the site. So what she's doing is showing us one set of buildings and how they evolved and changed over time by overlaying a still of her SketchUp model onto an aerial still of the trench, lining it all up, and then using, I think, Vimeo to create an online video presentation of how that building advances over time. I didn't tell her to do it that way. I said, think of a way in which you can show me how this building changes, and that's what she came up with. So it's integrating SketchUp into another kind of world of digital tools, online tools, free tools, paid-for tools, of her choosing. And I think that's a really nice result. I gave her a good mark for that. And she gave me a very nice written commentary to explain what she'd done. Quite a lot of the boys, I have to say, make the amphitheater. And that's a difficult one to make because you have to integrate it into a bowl of terrain. And I tell them all, this will hurt you. This will be really hard to do. But they still want to do it. And they produce some really cracking results. So this is the small mini Colosseum at Silchester. And you can see they put in human figures for scale and a sense of occasion. They put in a scaling mark for me, a northing mark there as well. So a nice presentation of the amphitheatre. This is a Roman motel called the Mancio, where travellers, Silchester was on the road network, lots of travellers coming through it. So this was an important place to break your journey, have a bath in the suite of bathhouses there. You can take the roofs off those and look into the different hot and cold and warm rooms inside the bathhouse.
More like Super 8 or Holiday Inn?
Yeah, it's probably not the most glamorous motel in the Roman Empire, but a bed for the night, hopefully quite a clean bed, and a bath, hopefully in quite clean water, and then on your way. And then the Forum Marketplace Law Court building in the heart of the town. So some very nice work. So I think, hopefully you can see from this that I can take non-specialist students, give them not an enormous amount of tutorial time, tell them the academic structure that I want them to operate in, and I get from them really nice results. Pleasingly, although the best students are always going to perform well at whatever module they take, because this is a different learning style, some students who are very good visually and adept visually or practically on the computer, but maybe not the strongest students in their written work, have a chance to shine here. And we get some very high marks from people in this module whose marks elsewhere in more conventional things with essays and exams are a bit lower. So this is a nice outlet for them. And I get students telling me that having done this, they then want to take it further to integrate digital work into other kind of essays that they're writing or the dissertations they want to write. I get a lot of enthusiasm and good feedback from the students for this. And recently I got a National Teaching Award from the Guardian newspaper based on this. So it feels to me that this is well supported by my institution, by my students. It's attracting a bit of, in the UK at least, a bit of attention and momentum as being something distinctive and unusual within the context of humanities degrees, which are always looking to be relevant and employable and so on. In the UK, that's the climate. I don't know what it's like here, but we're always trying to justify ourselves. Why study the ancient world? Because it's interesting is the answer, but then you've got to say, well, what do I do with it at the end? So for all these reasons, this is currently quite a popular thing in my university, and it's attracting attention elsewhere in the UK as well from people who want me to come and talk to them about it. I think there's a lot of scope for future development. This is me yesterday in Aaron and Phil's headset, and this got me thinking. Aidan told me that the headset only made me look 5% dorkier, which I guess is a compliment. So I think immersive 3D environments, when Silchester's finished, when my students have made Silchester, I want to put it all into Unity and have a website where you can walk around room in Silchester. I think that would be good. I want to work on my workflows for lighting and rendering, because putting everything to C4D works for the whole of Rome. I have to use something that high-end and powerful, but for smaller sites, individual buildings, I want to look at rendering plugins, probably. The question of change over time that someone asked me about, certainly I want to do that. Rome 1.0 has taken me 5 years. If I'm going to do five of them, changing every century, it's going to take me the rest of my career. So that will be a research funding grant application for me to make, I think. Thinking about adding in layers, lighting, people, noise, dirt. In Aaron and Phil's presentation yesterday, there was a guy working on acoustic spaces for Greek rhetoric, and I could do a lot of the similar sort of stuff with my Roman theatres, or what was it like in the bathhouse with the thundering of the fountains and the thousands of people milling about. I've got a book contract with Cambridge University Press for this summer to do a visual guide to ancient Rome, but what I really want to do is a tourist smartphone app for ancient Rome, where you can take the model and kind of whiz it around on your tablet or phone. So I need to find a developer partner for that. So there's lots of stuff in the future in the pipeline, lots of potential, and Basecamp has been great for showing me some avenues for pursuing this. But I'll give the last word to some of my students, just show you some of the stuff they're creating. This is a guy who had never touched visualization software before when he started the course last October. A couple of weeks ago, he handed in this, which is a timber framing structure for the roof of a Roman building. I've given you just a tiny excerpt of his very long commentary that tells me how he went into Vitruvius, an ancient architectural writer, and found out all the Latin names for tie beams and rafters and purlins, and how he worked out how all this stuff slotted together. I was very impressed by this. I hadn't asked him to make this, but this is what he chose, he found interesting and he wanted to pursue. And I think a visual expression of this is by far the best way of explaining how a Roman timber roof slotted together. I mean, why do it in 100 pages of writing when you can do it in one model and 10 pages of writing? And a couple of other projects from this term that I liked. This lady who made this Roman temple. At the top, excerpt from her commentary about her learning experience with SketchUp. At first, I got frustrated. I didn't realize I made a mistake until I'd gone too far in and I had to, you know, lose hours of work. And I keep telling them, make backups, make backups. This time, I made sure I made regular backups and went through situations in detail. And I look forward to improving my skill as I experiment with SketchUp at my own leisure. So she's going to carry on using the software now for ever, I guess, making other things that aren't Romano-Celtic temples like this one that she built here. And this one, this sweet little model of a small, humble Roman cottage from the site that a student made with a demountable roof group so you can look inside. And she made all the furniture, which is all based on finds from Silchester that are documented and in our town museum. And she gave a long commentary on how she made the bed. And if you take the mattress off, she's got a Roman cord sprung netting underneath it to hold the mattress. And she's got, you know, Samianware pottery that she's taken a pot profile and lathed it to make tableware and put the appropriate colors on it. And then so she went through all this. And she said at the end, this would be a good teaching tool. So I want to be a school teacher, she said. So I set up a work experience session for myself at a high school in Leeds. And I took it into a class that was learning about Roman Britain. And I used this model as an impressive teaching tool for a generation of school children that has not lived without computers. I think that's important. I mean, all the 18-year-olds that come to study with me have grown up with Rome Total War and with Gladiator, with kind of immersive 3D environments as their natural birthright. And they want to, when they study the ancient world, they want that to be there. And so this person has created one for herself and then taken it into a class of school children and used that as a teaching tool. So this is the next generation after the one that I've been teaching now, being primed with SketchUp modeling of the ancient world, which I think is probably a nice place to end. So thank you very much for your attention and for your questions. That's what I like to think, yeah. And I make the parameters of the exercise quite broad. I tell them, this is essentially what I want, but you have to get to where you're going by working out how to use this tool set. And I think that kind of building in of independence and learning how to use a new tool like SketchUp is as important a part of a university educational experience as just learning some facts about ancient Rome would be.
Is there a possibility that, since I'm now retired, I might be able to come to Reading and actually finish it?
Yeah, please come and take my City of Rome MA. Or do people know what MOOCs are? Is that an acronym that's current? Massively open online courses. This is the current, in the UK at least, we've just caught up to the States with this. And Reading University, my university, is in the UK quite a leader in MOOCs. And when I get back, the next thing on my to-do list is to write a pitch to them for an ancient Rome MOOC using this material. So if we do that, then you could take that for free from your own desk. But if you want to come to Reading and study the ancient world, all of you, please, please do. My head of department would be delighted.
Are there historians doing other cities and other towns, say London 1665?
Not in the UK, not that I know of, but I'm sure there are pockets of people doing this out there, and something that I want to do, I've just applied for a teaching fellowship in the UK, and if that comes off, I want to set up a network of people doing this kind of thing to try and pool and share expertise. There are specialist computer research centres which have teams of kind of graphics professionals and IT professionals, but I don't think it's yet got down much to my level, which is like the individual non-specialist academic doing it off their own bat in the department. But I think my point is that SketchUp makes it easy or possible for us to do that. So I would like to see more of that kind of thing. And I think it's very transferable to 17th century London and other places.
Have you thought of writing a book about how the processes that you went through and how you did it so that anybody could
get you? If people think that would be an interesting book to create, then yeah, I'd like to do that. I've got currently two books stacked up on the top of my head that I've actually got to sit down and write at some point when I can tear myself away from SketchUp. Once those are out the way, that would be an interesting thing to do. And I wonder whether a book or a YouTube channel in the first instance or something would be a good way of trying to promulgate some of this stuff and talk about it. But this process of using SketchUp as a university educator as opposed to an architect, a landscape architect, or whatever, I think is something a bit distinctive and maybe there's a project there. Okay, well, if you want to make your checks payable to me now, I promise to write the book. Any other questions from people?
Is your work accessible publicly at all, like your work as a
Yeah, some of it is. Making better websites is yet another thing that's always on the to-do list. But a lot of the Rome content, my publishers, now I'm under contract, tell me I can't really just stick it all online, otherwise no one will buy the stuff they want to sell. But I have got a sample of it there. And I'll give you my card as well if you want it. And I've also got a quite, at the moment, quite a limited blog there, which I talked about the technical geeky stuff at the moment, but I might expand that. I might put a Basecamp entry on that as well. So there's some stuff online, yeah. Once the book is out of the way and Cambridge tell me what I can release publicly, I'll do that. And the MOOC that may be coming in 2015 will be based entirely on this material. So anyone who wants 10 hours of tuition on ancient Rome flying around the city will do it that way. I guess I better let you go to the next session. Thank you so much for coming along.